If you ever catch me moaning, show me where to go. If it's how tough my life is, singing on the radio, don't give me house room. Don't be polite. While some voice is silenced for a loaf of bread in the dead of night. I want my MTV, my picture book, my interactive video. Don't give me house room, but a scornful look. Some soul makes a midnight spread to a sniper sights for a library book. Catch me spouting hatred, firmly close the door. There's enough to go around already. We do not need any more. Don't give me house room. Don't let me.
Michael Marra there, and I'm delighted to welcome to Travelling Folk the man himself. Hello, Michael.
Hello, Bruce.
How are you tonight?
Yes, I'm fine.
Now, I'm going into this interview really in the dark here tonight because I got the CD this afternoon with not a piece of paper attached to it or anything like that. So you're going to have to tell me everything about it.
Oh.
It's a six track, I know that.
Uh-huh.
what's the idea behind it? What is what's the band behind it as well?
Well, the Hazey Janes are the group, and that's two of my bairns. Alice and Matthew, and Liam Brennan and Andrew Mitchell. Now, we've always kind of kept clear of each other. And, you know, they got on with their thing and I got on with mine. But they were playing over in Tobermory, and Gordon McLean suggested that we should do something together. And I was in favour. I think it's a great idea. I love my bairns, and Liam and Andrew as well. So we got together. They chose the songs. I think that was quite significant, really.
They're all your songs?
They are, yeah. But they were the Hazeys chose them. And I think that's a good way to be with my stuff. If somebody else chooses the material, I think you get a better result.
Yeah. Now, for those of our listeners who perhaps haven't heard the Hazey Janes, mm-hmm. you know, what kind of background, what kind of music is it they play?
Well, they play songs. They all write songs together. They have a great studio technique. I noticed that. They're very diligent. You know, the studio clock, it can be pretty, fierce.
Yes, yes, it can.
It can be very fast and expensive. And I noticed that. I was very proud of that. They worked very well together. Most of their records, they made one album in Spain and one in America, and the last one they made here. So I hadn't actually worked with them in the studio. And it was great. It just all worked very well and everything sat. It was good fun, it was good humoured, and we ended up with a good range. Yeah. With one more day, actually, we could have had a full album in with another day.
Yeah, you surprised me saying that the clock was ticking in Tobermory, and I just can't believe that. There was a clock. It's the island that just doesn't bother sleeping, is it? They just certainly when Gordon's involved in music over there, it's a very relaxed atmosphere, isn't it? It's a great place
true.
To work.
That it is. It's lovely. But there is a very definite sense of industry. It's not as if you... you know, you don't hang about there wondering what to do next. Actually, that's a pretty big trick that Gordon pulls. Whilst you are feeling that you're relaxed and in a wonderful place, he does keep it moving. It's a good trick for any producer.
Yes, absolutely. Now, as well as talking about the new album, and we're going to listen to another... we don't call it a full album now. What do we call them? They're EPs, isn't it?
EPs. I always liked the EP. I always liked that form. I bought Twist and Shout by the Beatles, and that was... The EP is a wonderful form.
It is. It's a great for. It means that you can try a lot of different musical styles on just one little project, doesn't it?
It you're does. Not,
yeah, that's it. Now, we're here to talk about your musical influences and, you know, something that you mentioned there, you bought the Beatles as an early influence. But I look at your first choice here tonight and it's from a CD called American Yodeling. Fantastic. Now, how did this end up in your hands?
Well... that was to do with the family thing there, because I'm recording with my bairns, and I was thinking about spectacularly good acts which have come about because they were in the same family, you know, like the Mills Brothers or the Beach Boys or the Everly Brothers,
yeah.
Where you get absolute perfection because they've been together from day one. And I remembered another example of that some many years ago. I saw a gig in Dundee, and it was Phil Cunningham with his brother John. Now, that definitely had what I'm talking about. You know, a really spectacular knowledge of each other's techniques, mm-hmm. and consequently... great entertainment for everybody else, and very, very impressive. But it's because they've been together all their days. And these girls were sisters, the De Zurich sisters. And to be able to sing, you know, so closely together is incredible. To be able to yodel together like that, it's unbelievable.
Are you a keen yodeler yourself?
I used to be.
Yeah, it's one thing I'd love to be able to do. You know, whistling I would like to do, but yodeling, I think. I actually had an album, it was called, I think it was the best yodeling songs in the world, and I was on tour with Blazing Fiddles, and I played it kind of to death, and eventually our guitarist, Mark Clement, reached to the CD, ejected it, and threw it out the window, and then the M1 somewhere, so I lost the album forever, but I do love a good yodel.
Oh, I do. And also, I remember an actor called Graham Valentine said, he saw an album in a shop by Harry Durrani, and it was called I Will Yodel All Day. And he said, I said to myself, now there's a positive statement.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think we all deserve to hear De Zurich Sisters. And this is The Arizona Yodeler.
Folks you meet all know a thing or two. Lives a lad of great ambition, who had set as his life's mission to excel upon his oldie-da-da-da-do. And he'd play a little tune on his Spanish guitar. He'd mingle with a song, the sweet refrain. In the evening in the cactus, he would get a lot of practice on his yodel-dee-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da Once a big shot from the city heard him warble in the ditty, and a company was oodly-diddy. Then he said, look here, my sonny, you can make a lot of money with the oodly-diddy-diddy-diddy-diddy-diddy-diddy-diddy-diddy. And he'd play a little tune on his Spanish guitar. He'd mingle with a song that's sweet and refrain. Then our hero took the tip and packed his grip and took a trip and soon was singing o'er the radio to you. If the Swiss heard what he's earning, green with envy they'd be turning when he met a little maiden who was talent who was laden, and she fell for him like flowers for the dew. And he wished not to evade her, and he used to serenade her with his yodity-da-day-yodity-da-day-doo. And he'd play a little tune on his Spanish guitar. He'd mingle with a song the sweet refrain.
I am going straight out to get that tomorrow. It's fantastic, isn't it?
That makes me glad to be alive.
Absolutely. Now, I knew we were going to get good choices from you because I did hear your show, My Life in Five Songs, with Phil Cunningham. And I think you picked the Caterpillar song, and I knew we were going to get a treat.
Oh, the inchworm.
The
yes.
Winchworm, sorry. That's yes. What it is. Yeah. Yeah. Now, the crafting of songs is something that you are renowned for throughout Scotland. Is it something that you really admire in other songwriters? Do you analyse other songwriters?
I do, actually. Well, you can't help it, because the great ones from whom you learn very big things. I mean, I you know, the great songwriters say a lot more in a few words than you know, poets take a verse to say. There are some great examples. Randy Newman was a great one for me about being dramatic, using drama, saying a lot within a short phrase. He's really wonderful at that kind of thing.
Yeah. And what I love about songs, and great songwriters do this very well, is they write a song and everyone is convinced that their interpretation of that song is correct.
Uh-huh.
You know, I think that's a great skill, being able to leave it still open to interpretation, and being able to tell a story, I think, is one of the most amazing things. And quite a few people have chosen your songs in the kind of top three thing that we do in the first hour of the programme. You've had a few songs selected in that, and people have always been, you know, very just amazed at your ability to create an atmosphere and tell a story. And is that something that you've really had to work at?
Well, it was something that I discovered. I can't remember the first example of it, but I remember the reaction to it was that people came forward. And like you said earlier, sometimes they said things about it which I hadn't intended at all.
Mm-hmm.
And now that is interesting, because once you know that, you can then leave things open to different interpretations. You know, you can actually organise them to bring that about, whilst being sympathetic universally. Well, you know, you can't do that. But when you listen to people like Tom Waits or Paul Simon especially, I absolutely love Paul Simon for that. He seems to come up with, they're more like movies, you know, they're like great short stories or little films where he creates a complete atmosphere and tells you a story about somebody, and you end up in the end, you end up wondering about yourself.
Well, you know, I think you've described perfectly there. Hairmless has been selected as a song by quite a few people for the top three thing, and actually we've got somebody's just got in touch. Gilly Banks has got in touch about that song. The Buke Folk Festival director Danny Kyle singing it on his last CD. It was one of those songs that really captured the imagination. In fact, it was up there for national anthem at one stage, wasn't it? People would say.
Well, it has a nice, peaceful kind of message to it. You know, it's. I like the idea about the, the non-dramatical kind of heroism of ordinary people. Mm-hmm. People who just get on with whatever they're doing, you know. These people seem to be unusual these days.
Yeah, I think it was Rod Patterson, actually, who was on the programme, and he was talking about the song, and he just said, you know, so many songwriters, it's a song about I, me, and that's what your songs aren't about. And, you know, they're very much looking outwards. And I would imagine you're a very dangerous friend to have, actually, sitting around you. You'd be taking notes, and the next thing you'd be in the middle of a song.
Yeah, well, now, couldn't have dragged me into my songs. That would cause trouble.
Well, the reason I was talking about songwriters there is that what you're currently listening to just now, Leonard Cohen.
Oh, and yes.
There we have something special, don't we?
Oh, that's it's a beautiful album. It's called Old Ideas. And Leonard, this has just been a really great comfort to me, actually. I noticed one of the lines in the song Going Home. He describes it as a manual for living with defeat. That's it. Thank you very much, Leonard. It's a beautiful record, and there's quite a few different producers involved. Uh-huh. And yet, it works very well as a collection. You know, the colours all work with each other. And like I say, I find them very comforting. And he says some simple things so directly that it's just beautiful, and you wonder why you didn't do it yourself.
So always the best ones, isn't it? Why didn't I think of that? Yeah. Well, let's have a listen to that. This is Leonard Cohen.
I'd love to speak with Leonard. He's a sportsman and a shepherd. He's a lazy bastard living in a suit. But he does say what I tell him, even though it isn't welcome. He just doesn't have the freedom to refuse. He will speak these words of wisdom, like a sage, a man of vision, though he knows he's really nothing but the brief elaboration of a tube. Going home without my sorrow, going home sometime tomorrow, going home to where it's better than before. Going home without my burden, going home curtain, going home without the costume that I wore. He wants to write a love song, an anthem of forgiving, a manual for living with defeat. Doesn't have a burden, that he doesn't need a vision, that he only has permission to do my instant bidding, which is to say what I have told him to repeat. Going home without my sorrow, going home sometime tomorrow, going home to where it's better than before. Going home without my burden, going home behind the curtain, going home without this costume that I wore.
stuff. Leonard Cohen there. And Michael, that's the opening track of the album. That's quite a statement, isn't it?
It is. Aye. Oh, it's wonderful. Really, I just love this record.
Yeah, I was just reading a little bit about him there, and you know, he was kind of forced back into touring again. I think, you know, the manager was embezzling.
Stole all his money.
That's right, yeah, yes. Yeah. And then we had John Cleese back out touring because his ex-wife took him to the cleaners then. And, of course, there's the Willie Nelson in the tax case. Now, these guys were all kind of forced back out on tour. Do you think that motivation to tour, you know, if you were loaded and never had to tour again, would you still be drawn to going out on the road again, do you think?
I'm not sure that I would, but it'll produce different results in each of those people. Because I remember Randy Newman saying that his wife told him that they had no money. And in the following month, he wrote a record called Little Criminals, which was an absolute classic. Now, he didn't think he would have written that if she hadn't told him that they had no money. So in some people, it will produce wonderful art. In others, it will produce inferior work, which they'll be dragging about with them.
Yeah.
In order to, you know, like chains. So it would depend who you are.
Absolutely.
Leonard has done it beautifully, in fact.
Yeah.
And I would expect him to be a bit more philosophical about losing all his money anyway.
Probably had so much he never realised he'd lost half of it anyway.
Well, yeah. No, I knew he had most of it.
Yeah, yeah. So you're going out on tour, actually, and it's an amazing little tour. Very select venues you're going to, starting on the 22nd of March in Iona Hall, and then Antober on the 23rd of March, and Easdale Island and the Borough Hall in Dunoon on the 25th of March. Uh-huh. That's a great bit of scheduling. You're not having to. You're going to some of those beautiful places on the planet.
I'm only playing beautiful places.
That's great if you can choose them that way, isn't it?
Oh, lovely. Yes.
Now, before we hear another track from the EP, mm-hmm. we got an email here, and please wish Michael Marra a happy 60th birthday last week. This is from the Martin Bennett Trust. Michael's performance in Martin's Liberation track is hailed as being one of the best Martin Bennett tracks ever. It's also on the new album I, which is out on Monday, and we're going to play a track from that in just in a few minutes. But I'm really interested because I went through the album today, looking at, you know, reading all the notes, and you know, there's lovely platitudes from the likes of Alex Salmon and Sean Connery about its importance to Scotland, etc. But you actually worked with them at the coalface, as it were, and you knew what he was like as a person. So I mean, how important do you think he was?
Who is this?
Martin Bennett.
Oh, Martin. Well, it's difficult to think. I find it difficult to think about Martin because I wonder what he would have done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what he would be doing now. I was an absolute one-off. And the fact that he was so young, it is incredible that we got the amount of work out of him that we did. So we should think ourselves as lucky. But he really does make me wonder what what would have been next. And he was so versatile as well. You know, he was very, very big. His thinking was very big. And I love that when people are, you know, bold enough to forge ahead like he did. And he was a great example to everybody.
Yeah. Well, as I say, we're going to play a track of his very shortly. It's just when I saw that email coming in from the Martin Bennett Trust, I thought I'd ask you. And, you know, getting words from politicians and famous actors is all very well, but somebody who's actually worked with him is always a lot more meaningful somehow, isn't it?
Oh, he was a lovely guy to work with.
Yeah.
That was in Tobermory as well. I worked with him there. I remember that as very, very joyous.
Great.
Joyous time.
Yeah. Well, Michael, it's been great chatting to you. Thank you very much for coming into the studio tonight. And we're going to hear the final track on the EP, Heaven's Hound. Tell us a little bit about this.
Heaven's Hound, I wrote after I saw that film, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? Now, the film is led by the songs. And in almost every song, whoever is singing cannot wait to die. Now, I don't feel like that about life. So I wanted to write a song in that style, you know, in the kind of poor white people's music is what it was. And two friends of mine, Hilda and Michael Craig, were going on a journey on the Mississippi on a riverboat. So I imagined them coming ashore at some place and getting lost and finding themselves in the kind of place where these songs arise.
Well, Michael, thank you very much for joining us here on Travelling Folk, and best of luck with the tour.
Thank you very much.
I hope people come out and see you there. That's Thursday the 22nd of March in Iona Hall, right down to the 25th of March in Dunoon. OK, Michael, cheers for now.
Thank you, Bruce.
And here is Michael Marra and Heaven's Hound.
Was a cold and a rainy night, a lodging bell rung. Come open up and let us in, my darling is done. We have come along a rocky road, the young voice did call. Let us lie down and rest and bid peace to you all. But there came no reply and they slowly moved on. Not even a light there to guide the forlorn. As he steadied her shoulder, he sang soft and low. Should the Lord take my darling, then I also must go. To that heavenly shore, in the light we'll arrive. We have only our love here to keep us alive. If all else has failed us, we'll travel no more. We will bathe in the light of that heavenly shore. The young woman stumbled and finally she fell. And her husband, he cried out the anguish of hell. As he held her close to him, a moment of grace. Then a hound moved beside them and it licked at her face. Oh, the husband was angry and he railed at the hound. But his sweetheart was smiling as she slowly came round. Oh, I had a dream, I had made heaven's gate. There was no sign of you, so they told me to wait on that heavenly shore. In the light we'll arrive. We have always our love here to keep us alive. So help me, for we have a long way to go before we bathe in the light on that heavenly shore. On that heavenly shore, in the light we'll. We have always our love here to keep us alive. So help me, for we have a long way to go before we bathe in the light on that heavenly shore.
Thanks again to Michael Marra, and best of luck to him with the tour and the EP. It was also great to hear his experiences of Martin Bennett.